Hey, I'd like to welcome everyone to worship today. Let's all stand as we sing the old hymn, The Eastern Gate.
I will meet you in the morning, just inside the Eastern Gate. So be ready, faithful pilgrim, lest with you it be too late. I will meet you. Just inside the Eastern Gate over there, I will meet you, I will meet you, I will meet you in the morning over there. If you hasten off to glory, linger near the Eastern Gate, for I'm coming in the morning, so what a blessed, happy meeting just inside the Eastern Gate. I will meet you, I will meet you just inside the Eastern Gate over there. I will meet you, I will meet you, I will meet you in the morning over there. Just inside the Eastern Gate over there, I will meet you, I will meet you, I will meet you in the morning over there.
I wanted to do something a little different this morning. God put something on my heart this past week, and I feel like I really needed to share it with everyone. I do not do public speaking. It is not my thing at all. And I know that seems really weird because I sing up here on stage, but I still get nervous when I do that. So there's that. Last weekend, I went to a birthday party. And before I say this, I need you to know this has absolutely nothing to do with me and everything to do with God. But the sweetest lady came up to me at this birthday party, and she told me that the first time she came to our church and she heard me sing, she just felt like she was home. And I don't know why. It wasn't me, but I don't take compliments very well, so all I could do was just look at her and almost cried because she said, I've tried all these churches, and this one just felt like home. So all I could do was just thank you so much and almost cried, but I really just felt like I didn't know what to say to her because I'm just an ordinary person like all of you are. So that was an extremely huge thing for her to say. But I never once gave God glory in that moment, and it bothered me. Monday morning, I was driving to work, and sometimes I do my best talking to God in the mornings or when I'm in the car, ride home, when I have quiet time. So he started talking to me and speaking to me, and I had that conviction of not sharing with her that, you know, I do this for God, and God gave me this gift. And sometimes I don't always think I do a great job at it, but that's not, he gave it to me, and I have to use it anyways. But he used me in that moment for her, but it wasn't me, it was him. But it made me start thinking about how all of us have things that God needs us to do for him, but that we're scared and we're fearful, or sometimes we just don't think we're good enough. And you never know that if you're just greeting someone at the door or any little thing that you're doing in our church, how much that can mean to someone. Not just being up here on stage. I'm just like you are. This is no better than anything that you would ever do in this church. You don't hold us to any high standards because this is just what God gave us and we're using it. But you could do just as much as any of us or as Brother Rick does. And I just want you to know that you're good enough. God gave you, if he's speaking to you, don't be fearful. I've been fearful too many times in my life and I've held back and I miss those moments like that I could have touch someone. So I just felt like I needed to get past my fear this morning and share that with you guys. and just hope that I can give someone some encouragement to, if God's speaking to you, please don't sit on it. Don't let Satan tell you not to do it, because he told me not to do that this morning. And now I'm so thankful that I did, even if I feel like I'm a blubbering mess. But I just really hope that you guys just listen to that voice and just step out and do what he's asking you to do, because it will make a difference, even if you don't know it, to someone's life. So if you all would, please stand with us and just, whatever worries or fears you have this morning, please give them over to God and just sing with us and just be in the moment with us.
I come before you today, and there's just one thing that I want to say.
Thank you, Lord. Stretched on, I'll bless your name. Thank you, Lord.
I just want to
thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. For
all you've done in my life. You took my darkness and gave me your light.
Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord.
You took my sin and my shame. You took my sickness and healed all my pain.
Thank you, Lord. With a song of praise, with an outstretched arm, I will bless your name. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. I just want to thank you, Lord.
To breathe the air of heaven, where pain is gone and mercy fills the streets, to look upon the one who bled to save me and walk with him for all eternity. Every prayer we prayed in desperation, the songs of faith we sang through doubt and fear, and in the end we'll see that it was worth it when he returns to wipe away our tears. Face to face with he who died. thousand generations. Sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. And on that day, we join the resurrection and stand beside the heroes of the faith with one voice, a thousand generations. Sing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Forever he shall reign. So let it be today, we shout the hymn of heaven.
Is all that I can do. In desperation, I'll seek heaven and pray this for you. I'll pray for your healing, that circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name, in Jesus' name.
I speak the name of all authority, declaring blessings, every promise he is faithful to keep.
I speak the name no grave could ever hold. He is greater, he is stronger, he's the God of possible. I pray for your healing, the circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough would happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name.
Come believe it, come receive it. Oh, the power of His Spirit is now forever yours.
Come receive it. In the mighty name of Jesus, all things are possible.
I pray for your healing, that circumstances would change. I pray that the fear inside would flee in Jesus' name. I pray that a breakthrough
happen today. I pray miracles over your life in Jesus' name. I pray for revival, for restoration of faith. I pray that the dead would come alive in Jesus' name. In Jesus' name.
Amen. You may be seated. Man, I appreciate the worship team so much. Appreciate their preparation and being willing to sing to the Lord. And, man, I'm glad to have Brother Matt back. You know, he was out of town this week with work, and we had revival. And, you know, any time that I lead worship, boy, it makes me appreciate him even more. I started to hug his neck this morning when I come in. But I really appreciate all the hard work that goes in. And I told him in the 8 o'clock service, man, the guys that run the sound and the lights and the screens, man, I appreciate all you guys do in your service. Guys, they come early. They come before everybody, and they put a lot of work in. I really appreciate them. Hey, can I say something before we get in? I know I can. I got the mics. I'm not even going to ask permission. Look, all right, y'all know I'm a change guy, man. I like to swap things up and change things up, and we have really made a conscious effort to get out of the routine of normal church service. That's why we start early. That's why we... one time we wasn't even doing it. Now I want to do things different. I don't like for us to get in the routine of church. I think that's dangerous. I think it makes us comfortable in who we are. And I just want to encourage you that you are not going to be judged and upon in an awkward way if the Holy Spirit is leading you to praise the Lord. If you feel compelled to go to an altar at any point in the service, it might be during the song service. It might be while I'm preaching. Now, don't come up here with your fist up. Don't like you want to throw hands or something. But no, if I'm joking. If you feel like that's and you know that that's where God is urging you. Now, I don't want to show. I don't want anybody to ever do anything in here out of your own or out of being fake. But if you feel urged by the Holy Spirit, be obedient to it, because your obedience to that may be what I need. Your obedience to that may be what somebody else needs. And man, I'm telling you, revival was great this week, and I appreciate everybody that came out. I felt like the Spirit of God moved. I feel like every message was for me. I feel like that God knew that I needed reviving, and he sent the speakers that we needed, and they were fantastic all week long. And I hope that you did come out and that you know that God is working through you. And, man, I appreciate you coming back this morning and being willing to be in God's house. Take your Bible. That was just, I want us to have freedom in worship. That's what I want us to have. I want us to be free to worship the Lord and be free to be moved by the Holy Spirit. Because if we come in this place and God urges us to do something and we don't obey and we don't do it and then we leave unchanged, what have we done? What have we done? So let's be obedient this morning. Let's go to 2 Corinthians chapter 5 is where we're going to be. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. A lot of scripture this morning. I told Matt Rice, going to be kind of like sword drill this morning. But Matt takes care of you, man. He throws it up there on the screen, and so it'll be up there if you need it. We're going to be in 2 Corinthians chapter 5. 2 Corinthians chapter 5. You know, I hear preachers, I've heard multiple messages. I like to, I've got certain preachers I like to listen to. I've got certain guys that they're good illustrators, and they do a good job getting the point across, and I sometimes watch their videos. I like Christian comedians. I love guys that can make fun of themselves and other people, and they don't even care if you're offended, and they do it in Jesus' name. I love that. And I got one particular guy, Michael Jr. I'm gonna promote him this morning. If you get a chance to hear anything from Michael Jr., he's a really good Christian comedian. But anyway, he does this sermon, and he's talking about what is our why. And I've heard multiple preachers preach a message and ask or to tell Christians, we need to figure out what our why is. What is our why? Why do we do what we do? Why do we follow after Jesus in obedience? Why do we, why are we motivated to live a life for Christ? And when I saw that, I thought about the why statement and what our why is. But see, I think that our why is because God created us to live for Him. I believe that ought to be enough. I believe our why is because Jesus commanded us to live for Him. Jesus commanded us to go and reach our neighbor. Jesus commanded us to go and be the salt and be the light. That is our why. It doesn't take a deep soul searching. Oh, I wonder what all's going on. I wonder when I'm going to get my call. I wonder. Hey, we've been called. You hear me? We've been called. We've been called out by God. Our why is because Jesus died for us and rose again to give us the opportunity to live a life that glorifies Him. You don't need the preacher to come to you and explain to you why you should live for Christ. It's in God's Word. It's thus saith the Lord. It's what the Holy Spirit convicts us about. That is our why. See, for God's people, I think we need to get more concerned with our what. Not our, we know why. If you don't know why, you don't know Jesus. We are who we are because Jesus Christ is who the Bible says He is. Because He was God. He did come to this earth. He did live a perfect life. He did die for our sin, every last one. He rose again and lives today so that we can do the same. That is our why. What are we doing as evidence of this great gift of salvation that we have received? What are we doing? See, I believe some of us are waiting. We're waiting. And you're not waiting on Jesus to come back either. We ought to be looking forward to that, by the way. One of these days, Christ is going to come back. And it's going to be when we least expect it. It's what Jesus said. He said, not even the angels know when I'm going to come back, so you better be ready. Keep them lamps trimmed. I know that's not a term we use today. Keep your gas in your tank, man. Be ready. Be ready. That's what Jesus said. I believe too many believers are waiting for some level of spiritual maturity before they get involved in ministry of Christ. It's like we're sitting back waiting on Brother Rick to send us a letter. He says, oh, congratulations, you've now reached spiritual maturity. You can come serve. That's not going to happen. That's not the way it works. We are called. When we are saved, we are called by God into service. Jesus said, follow me. Not sit back and watch where I went. Not sit back and wait for somebody to come carry you. Follow me. What is our what? What are we waiting on? We're waiting on an opportunity that involves something that we like. Brother Rick, I'll go serve, but I like to do this. Or my children like to do this. I'll come serve when it's something they like. That's child worship, by the way. That's idolatry. That's forbidden even in the Ten Commandments. We are to pursue Christ. What evidence is coming from our life? You know what? This may be the best one. I'll serve, Brother Rick, when I'm not so busy. Y'all know when that day is coming? I don't either. If you do, let me know, because I haven't found it yet. Y'all waiting on retirement? I'm not. I'm on that Jesus coming back retirement plan, too. Man and I both, we're just going to work till somebody runs us off from where we are, I guess. I don't know. There's no retiring in our future. Guys, what are we waiting on? What? What is the evidence of what God's doing in our life? What is the evidence of His presence? What is the evidence that others can see? What are we doing for God? How are we adding to the kingdom? What part of our life can clearly be witnessed that it is given to God? What do others see in our life and they say that's, boy, they've been with God right there. I see it in them. See, now I always feel like I'm going to get in trouble when I start to talk about this. Because some of y'all don't know this. Some of y'all come to Sulphur Springs and you know it's a Free Will Baptist church. You really don't know what that means. You're kind of looking around to make sure Brother Rick ain't got snakes or, you know, I'm not going to speak in a tongue or jump a pew or anything like that. I might. I don't know. Not with the snakes, though. I'm out on that. If you see a snake, you should kill it. If it's up here, just shoot. I'll get out of the way. I don't do snakes. Free Will Baptists have a bad name among other Baptists that we believe in a works salvation. that you're saved by what you do. And I want to set the record straight today. That is not Free Will Baptist doctrine. And it is not a doctrine that is preached in this church. Let me be clear. You cannot earn your salvation by who you are, by what you do, by what you give, or even how often you attend church or activities. You cannot earn your salvation. It is a gift from God. It is given to us by God as a gift for us, not of ourselves, so that none of us can boast of it. It is what God has done for us. You also do not, wait a minute, did I just have a stroke? You also do not keep your salvation off that same criteria. You don't stay saved because you're doing work at the church, okay? You're in a relationship with Jesus Christ if you know it. Period. Our salvation is not based on our works or how good we are. Kyle, ain't you glad our salvation ain't based on how good we are? Boy, you'd be in trouble, man. Doggone it. I would be in big trouble. I would be. Thank you, man. I appreciate that. Any amen I can get from you, brothers, a step ahead. If we truly believe, listen to me now. If we truly believe in this almighty, amazing, supernatural God, and we do, amen, who created us, who saves us, who sustains us, if we really believe that Jesus Christ took our sin on his body and died for a debt that we cannot pay, and he rose again so that we can live a life that glorifies him, how can we not show evidence of such a great God? Where is it? Why is it that it cannot be seen? It should be seen. It should be seen. There should be evidence of this miraculous change. Amen? All right, I'm going to put this down on a level where y'all can get it. You go down here to your local hairstylist. You drop about $200 in there. Next time I see you, I ought to be able to look at you and say, man, that hair looks good. They did that hair right. Amen? You're going to drop cash on it. You ought to look good, right? You take your car down there to your local person that details cars. You drop $100. I shouldn't wonder when I see your car if it's been washed or not. I ought to be able to see myself in the shine, right? There's an evidence. It's clear that something has happened. Where's our evidence? Where's our what? What are we doing? Why do we think that it's normal to profess that we have the Holy Spirit, the living God, the King of Kings inside of us, but so few people see the evidence of it? Why? Where is it? Why don't our choices reflect it? Why doesn't our lifestyle reflect it? Why don't our lessons reflect it? In the New Testament, we find two books that were written. They're books in the Bible. They were letters that were written by the Apostle Paul to the Christians in Corinth. And Paul was writing them these letters. He's an older guy, you know. He's got a lot of experience. He's been with Jesus. And so he's teaching these churches, these new Christians. And he's helping them with issues that they're having in the church. And in 2 Corinthians, that's the second letter that he had written. And in chapter 5, he's telling them about how there should be a change that takes place in their life. That God is working them toward a ministry of reconciliation, to be reconciled with God, to be reconciled with man. And that's only something that he can do. Amen? That's only something that God can do. We can make peace with people, only God can reconcile us. So Paul is teaching on this. And in 2 Corinthians chapter 5, he begins to advise these believers on how their lives should change as believers. And we find this truth in verse 17. So 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17. If you got it, say, I got it. Some of you are thinking, good grief, it took you this long to get there. Here we go. Therefore, if anyone is in Christ, he is a new creation. The old has passed away. Behold, the new has come. Guys, we're going to take one verse today, this simple verse, and we're going to break it down, and we're going to look at what Paul was saying. And hopefully we're going to find out what must take place in the life of the believer for us to produce this evidence so that we can clearly say this is what we are doing for Christ. So the evidence of this change of what God has done in us, it begins with what we're going to find right here in verse 17. The first thing I want you to see, it begins with the presence of Christ. The presence of Christ. Look at verse 17. If anyone is in Christ, if anyone is in Christ. I want to draw your attention to if. We're going to start with that with if, because if makes this statement a conditional statement, right? If you see if, in most cases there is a then. So that if means there's a condition there. If you do this, then this happens. So when we read this, if anyone is in Christ. Well, when you see a conditional statement, that means there's a choice that is made. There's a choice that is made. Listen to me, God's people. You are drawn by the Holy Spirit. You are commanded by God. But if you are going to serve God, you're going to choose Him of your own free will. You're going to choose to serve God. The preacher's not going to make you. The wife's not going to beat you into it. God's not going to strong arm you into it. You got to choose. We have to choose. I, as your pastor, I have to choose. There's a choice. Did y'all know God created us with choice? You choose every day. You make choices every day in what you're going to do. And guys, we find this all the way back in creation. Look with me, if you will, to Genesis chapter 2. We'll go all the way back to what God told Adam in Genesis chapter 2. Genesis chapter 2, verse 15. It says, the Lord God took the man and put him in the Garden of Eden to work it and keep it. And the Lord God commanded the man, saying, you may surely eat of every tree of the garden, but of the tree of the knowledge of good and evil you shall not eat. For in the day that you eat of it, you shall surely die. Now for Adam, this was before he had any troubles, right? If you're a Bible scholar, you realize Eve has not been invented yet, right? Eve has not been brought into the picture yet. See, the ladies even giggled at that a little bit in the first service. You ladies were like, what's funny about that, Brother E? See, this was before Adam knew he could choose. He didn't know he couldn't choose anything until Eve came along, right? She had to tell him what to do. Come on, ladies, stay with me. Come on. Guys, so much of our life is reflected in the Garden of Eden. It's crazy to me. It's like God just keeps bringing that back to my mind. He's been doing it for a couple of years now. I'm going to write a book someday about the garden, because that's where all of our choices, all of our sin, all of our nature comes back to the garden. It comes back to it. Think about it for a minute. God placed Adam and Eve in perfection. Perfection. There was no sin. There was no hurt. There was no tiredness. There was no hunger. They could have anything that they wanted in the garden. Anything that they could want. Complete indulgence. God said, I love you. I'm blessing you. Go be fruitful, multiply, be happy. Listen, even the climate was perfect. He didn't give them clothes. So the climate must have been perfect, right? That'd have been unfair if it had been cold. It wasn't cold. It was perfect. Because that's what God makes things. He made it perfect. So there's just one thing that you can't do. One thing. There's just one tree. You got to stay away from it. You got to stay away from it. Have y'all ever thought like I thought, why was that tree like right there, you know? Why wasn't that tree like on Mount Everest? You know what I mean? Where you got to work and you got to toil to get up there. You know why? God wanted them to choose. Listen to me. God did not want Adam and Eve to choose sin. He wanted them to choose Him. He told them what to do. He told them what was right. He gave them everything that they needed and said, choose me. But boy, the devil's slick, man. The devil is slick. He didn't tempt Eve with something nasty, something ugly. Satan comes to you with something that seems so appealing. Something that could be so good. Something that just seems right. But it's not right if God forbids it. It's just not. So we've been dealing with this choice ever since. Why did God give them a choice? Because God loves it when we choose Him. God loves you just like you love your children. How many of you got grown children? Let me see a hand. It's not a reflection of you being old. Man, that's wisdom. Wisdom and grace that they're still here and you didn't off them when you thought about it. Okay, you got grown children. How many of you love it when they call? As long as they're not asking to borrow money, right? Yeah. No, you love it when they call. You love it. You can't wait to hear from them. You love to hear from them. Guys, listen to me. Jesus said, we know how blessed we are when we can do something for our children and we're imperfect. How much more does a Heavenly Father who is perfect want to do for us? How much more does a Heavenly Father who is perfect love us, provide for us, watch out for us? Guys, God will do it. God loves us. But God gives us a choice, and He wants us to choose Him. He wants us to choose Him. See, when God begins to convict our heart, we need to choose Him. This morning, when you're sitting in the service and the Holy Spirit starts dealing with you, we need to choose Him. When we don't, we might as well be chasing that tree. We might as well be hanging out on the tree. We need to be obedient to what God is leading us to do. Let's go back to verse 17. Start with a condition. If, he says, if anyone, okay? I love this. If anyone, all right? I'm going to take you to another passage of Scripture. Romans chapter 10, verse 9. This is when that same Apostle Paul is talking to the Christians in Rome. He says, because if you confess with your mouth that Jesus is Lord and believe in your heart that God raised Him from the dead, you will be saved. For with the heart one believes and is justified, and with the mouth one confesses and is saved. For the Scripture says, everyone who believes in Him will not be put to shame. For there is no distinction between Jew and Greek, for the same Lord is Lord of all, bestowing His riches on all who call upon Him. Get this, Romans 10:13. For who? Everyone who calls on the name of the Lord will be saved. Why is that significant, Brother Rick? Because Paul was telling them, no matter if you grew up Jew or Greek, no matter your background, no matter your sinfulness, no matter your lack of knowledge, no matter what you've been through, no matter what has gone on in your life, if you will choose Christ, if you will call upon His name, if you will make Him Lord of your life, you can be saved. You can be saved. Anyone can be saved. And you might be saying, Brother Rick, I just don't know why God would want me. Well, honestly, I really don't know why He does either. You low down, rotten scoundrel. I don't know why God wants you. But He does. Guys, there's a lot of days I don't know why God keeps fooling with me. And I'll tell Him so. But I'll say, God, I sure am thankful You do. I sure am thankful that You show me grace and mercy. I don't know why You do, other than the fact that You love me. See, Romans chapter 5, verse 8 says that God loves us so much that even while we were sinners, meaning we were lost and we didn't have a care about anything of God, Jesus Christ took our sin in His body and died for us. Man, that's love right there. He loves us. He loves us. Anyone who calls on the name of the Lord can be saved. Okay, look back to verse 17, 2 Corinthians chapter 5. If anyone is in Christ, if we are in Christ, how can we be in Christ, within Christ, a part of Christ? Guys, it means we are covered by Him. We let His life, His holiness, His death, His resurrection cover who we are. We let it become who we are. Listen to me. If we have asked Jesus to be the Lord of our life, and He is in us, in our hearts, then we are in Him. We are in Christ. Now, we go back to the whole, what can I do to show the evidence? What needs to happen in my life for my life to be evidence of who God is? Listen to me. The more we pursue God, the more we pursue God. What do you mean pursue God, Brother Rick? How's your prayer life? How's your prayer life? Don't talk to me about your church attendance. Don't talk to me about how much you love the Lord. How often do you give God that burden? Instead of you worrying, instead of you griping, instead of you telling somebody else, how is your prayer life? You want to pursue God, get on your face before Him. Go after Him. Pursue God. How's you reading the Word? How are you in the Word of God? Oh, Brother Rick, I don't like to read the Bible. Then get you a Bible out and listen to it. Quit making excuses, God's people. We're living in the 21st century, man. Come on, let's go. We got all this technology. Use it for something good. Use it for something good. We have no excuse. Get in God's Word. Well, I don't know how I'm supposed to live. Yes, you do. It's right here. God gave us an instruction manual. Learn how to read it. Get into it. I'm telling you, there's going to be no excuse when we stand before God. We're going to stand before God. Well, I just didn't like to read. God, you know, it's not going to fly. I was going to say, well, that's funny. You read them social media apps. You read them web pages. You do all this stuff with technology. Better get God's Word in it. Guys, the more we pursue God, the stronger His presence is inside of us. You want to know what it is to be in Christ? Then you allow Him into every avenue of your life. Stop holding Him back. Stop holding yourself back from Him. The more we spend time in prayer, the more we're in His Word, the more we have meditation, the more we have godly people around us. Change your friend group. You've been preaching at your kids for years about it. Get the people out of your life who are drawing you away from God. Get around people who love Jesus more than they love you, and you'll have you some friends. You have some people around you that can speak into you. So, we must be in His presence. The next thing that we see from the scripture, for us to be able to show this evidence of what God's doing, there's got to be a passing of self. Look at verse 17. The old has passed away. There must be a passing of self. Guys, we've got to die to ourselves. Now, I'm going to explain it to you a little bit. In Galatians chapter 2, verse 20, the Apostle Paul says this, I have been crucified with Christ. It is no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God, who loved me and gave Himself for me. Now listen, to live the life that God intends for us to live, we must put Christ first, okay? We must put Christ first. When we are born, we are all born into selfishness. Now listen, some of you are offended by that because you weren't selfish even before you were saved. Somehow your parents taught you and poured into you not to be selfish. But for the rest of the 99% of us, we're born selfish. We want it how we want it. We want it our way. We look for how things can benefit us the most. Before we know Christ, we are self-centered. We are the God of our own universe before we know Christ, because it revolves around us. That must change when we come to know Christ. This is what Paul is talking about when he says, I am crucified with Christ. At this point in Paul's life, he had not been crucified physically, right? He was writing a letter, so therefore he was not dead. He was still alive. So what did he mean, I have been crucified with Christ? He is saying that he has put to death or crucified his old passions, his old desires, his old way of thinking. He is no longer the old man that lives within him. He is made new in Christ. He has died to self, and now he lives for Christ. Now listen to me. Somebody needs to hear this principle this morning and understand it. Because I was 23 years old before my mind ever wrapped around this deal. I believed in God. I believed I was saved. But I was still all about me. I was a Christian who was stubborn, hateful, felt like I had to have everything my way. If I didn't, I pouted. Talked about people. If you didn't believe like I believed, then you were probably going to hell, and I was okay with that because I was right. There's too many of us that are living that way. It's got to be our way, what we want. It's hindering us from being who God wants us to be. I could not be the man that God was preparing me to be. God was preparing me to be a godly husband because I was about to get married. I think God knew that Miss Amanda would probably kill me if I didn't get things right. God was preparing me to be a godly father because in all of my selfishness, I didn't need to be raising anybody. Because it was all about me. One of the greatest things that I ever learned right up there in that brick church, Brother John Reed is my pastor, is that as a man of God, every day I have to die to myself. Being crucified in Christ, giving ourselves over to God, is not a one-time thing. Your salvation, yes, a one-time thing. Your recommitment to Christ better be daily. Your dying to your flesh better be daily. I was taught when I was 23 that every morning when I wake up, when I first look in that mirror, whether if it's oh my or man, got it going on today, I better die to myself. God, I'm giving you my life. God, I'm giving you my mind. I'm giving you my worry. I'm giving you my stress. I'm giving you my bad attitude. I want to kill it right now and live for you today. See, some of us, we get up with the best of intentions, but we come and put on a coat of worry first thing. We go wash our face with a bunch of doubt. We go in there and we mad because the coffee maker didn't work and now the whole day is going to be ruined. Because it's all about us. God's people, listen to me. We've got to die to ourselves. That's what Paul is talking about when he says, I am crucified. He says the passing, the old has passed away. I have gotten rid of it. I've put it off. Ephesians chapter 4, verse 22. He says to put off your old self, which belongs to your former manner of life and is corrupt through deceitful desires. When we are in Christ, we look at the world differently. We love the world differently, and we serve the world differently. We must put off our old man. The old things must pass away in order for us to be new. So if we want there to be evidence in our life of who we're serving, we got to put off the old man. He must pass away. This is the last thing. We're going to close with this. To show the evidence of God's presence in our life, we need the power of the Holy Spirit. Verse 17 says that if anyone be in Christ, the old man must pass away and the new must come. When you commit yourself to Christ, you're not just a better version of your old self. You know, if we're going to make something new, if we're going to do better, we'll clean up, get a haircut, shave, find some clean clothes, maybe put on a little cologne. Everything we do is outward. When we have Christ in us, the change is inward. It starts by our heart, what we love, what we pursue, and what comes out of us. We are new, and through Christ, we don't have the old power of our flesh, which was weak. We have the power of Christ. See, some of us feel like in our mind, we ought to be able to win that spiritual battle. Brother Rick, I've been serving the Lord for all these years. I ought to be able to quit fooling with the sin. I ought to be able to guard my eye. I ought to be able to do this and do that. You cannot do it on your own. If you could do it in your own power, Jesus would have never taken that cross up to Golgotha. He'd have decided in the garden, hey, there's another way. These cats can do it by themselves. But it didn't happen like that. Why did Jesus go to the cross and take on our sin? Because we needed his power within us in order to battle sin. Now listen to me. We can win the spiritual battle. God has told us that. But it's not by our own strength. It's by his strength. It's by the power that God has placed inside of us. I've told you all this before. The power of the Holy Spirit is the most amazing miracle that mankind has ever witnessed. You show me bodies that are healed. You show me miraculous rescues, all these things. You can have it. The change that can take place in the human heart is the most miraculous thing that's ever been. You can take someone who's hard-hearted, who is stubborn, who is bent on their own way, full of hatred, and you let the power of Christ come in them and the Holy Spirit come over their life, and they'll love people like you've never seen before. That's miraculous. That's God coming in and doing a mighty, mighty work. Guys, when a person gives their heart to Christ, a change takes place. Not just trying to do better, not just better choices, but it's a new way of looking at life. It's a new way of loving people. It's something that you wouldn't do on your own. When we commit ourselves to Christ, we begin to see as Jesus sees. We begin to hurt for things that Jesus hurt for. And our focus is no longer on what we want or what we can get, but on God's glory. John chapter 14, verses 16 and 17, Jesus said this, I will ask the Father and he will give you another helper. The King James Version says comforter, to be with you forever. Even the Spirit of truth, whom the world cannot receive because it neither sees him or knows him. But you know him, for he dwells with you and will be in you. When we commit ourselves to Jesus Christ, when we make him the Lord of our life, the Holy Spirit begins to dwell inside of us. We change. We change. Our life changes. Guys, listen to me. The Holy Spirit guides us toward the things that we need to do, draws us toward the things of God. The Holy Spirit convicts us when there are things we need to stay away from. Allows us to experience things that we wouldn't ordinarily experience. It's called discernment. You say, oh, brother, are you talking about some kind of mysticism? I'm telling you, the Holy Spirit is not of this world. And we are not just living by our own power. God has promised us that the Holy Spirit will dwell inside of us and help us know the truth. Draw us toward him. Convict us from sin. God never intended for us to live this life by our own power. The Holy Spirit's presence is with us. So we read this story in the book of Acts. In Acts chapter 4, Peter and John have gone before the Jewish council. And you know, they hate the name of Jesus. The Jewish council, they didn't accept Jesus. They rejected him. And Peter and John have just went and gave this great explanation of who Jesus is and his power and what he's done. And as Peter and John are standing there before the council, Acts chapter 4, verse 13, the Bible says, now when they, the council, saw the boldness of Peter and John and perceived that they were uneducated, common men, they were astonished and they recognized that they had been with Jesus. How did they recognize that they'd been with Jesus? Were they like Moses and their face was shining? Did they have the Jesus conference tag with the lanyard? The donkey sticker? I love Jesus? How did they know? Some of y'all get that on the way home. You're going to laugh about it. How did they know? It was evidenced by the truth that they told. It was evidenced by the boldness that they spoke with. They weren't in there ranting and raving about what they liked and what they didn't like. They were preaching the word of God with compassion and talking boldly about what God had done for all the world in a way that even the council couldn't deny. Man, they've been with Jesus. Guys, when we have been with Christ, there will be evidence in our life. There will be things that will come from us that bring glory to God. That's what Jesus Christ told us to do. Let our light so shine before men that they may see our good works and glorify Father, which is in heaven. Our what will come naturally when we've spent time and we are in Christ. So we're going to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. And I'm going to challenge you. If you are a follower of Christ, if you have made him Lord of your life, I want you to be very, very real with God this morning. Just ask him, God, is my presence with you evident in my life? Is there something in my life that others see and lets them know that I've been close to you? Hey, we can start small. Does my spouse know that I've been walking with you because of the way that I treat them? Because of the way I treat our children? Because of the way I can lay my worry down? Do my children know that I have been with you because they hear me pray for them? They hear me speak words of life and truth over them because that's what's in my heart? Do my coworkers know when I walk in they're about to get a dose of the Lord because I've been walking with him all morning? My friends that like to get out, have a great time together, do they know when they invite me and my family that we're about to bring the Lord to that conversation? Ask God. If you will be real with God this morning, he will be extremely real with you. And he's going to show you. Some of it he's already shown you. Holy Spirit's already convicted you. If you don't know Christ, you can want to do better as badly as anything on this earth. You know that? You can want it so badly. You can want your situation to get better. You can want your kids to do right. You want to turn away from your sin. You can want to be somebody who's respectable. You don't have the Holy Spirit dwelling in you, and you haven't made Jesus the Lord of your life, you cannot do it. You can run back and forth and set fire to the pews, and there will be no power, because the power that you need only comes from Christ. But here's the good news today. You don't have to climb a mountain to find it. You don't have to set fire to a pew. If you want Jesus, you just got to ask him. Lord, come be the Lord of my life. I'm tired of running. I'm tired of fighting. You know, the Apostle Paul, we're told in the book of Acts, that the Apostle Paul, when he was Saul the persecutor, he thought he was doing good for God. The Lord blinded him on the road to Damascus. And he cried out and he said, Lord, is that you? You know what Jesus said to him? He said, Saul, Saul, why are you fighting against the direction that I'm trying to take you when I've got a better way? In the King James Version, he says, Paul, why are you kicking against the pricks? Which would have been like, why are you kicking the end of a sharp shovel? Some of you are banging your head, trying to get life to go right, when you really just need to get on your knees before God and give him your life. Give it to him. If the Holy Spirit is drawing you, because God's got purpose for you, he's working in you, wants to do something great through you. So we're going to go to the Lord in prayer this morning. We're not going to sing. I'm not even going to ask you to stand. I'm going to ask you to be obedient to what the Holy Spirit is doing in your heart. And if you need to pray this morning, you don't let anything stand between you and this altar. You want to know what you can do to be a better parent? You can get an altar. You want to know what you can do to be a better husband, a better wife, a better worker, a better Christian? Get an altar. Give it to God. Let him lead you. Let the Holy Spirit take control. Let's go to the Lord in prayer this morning. If you need to come, be obedient and come. Heavenly Father, God, we thank you so much for your goodness. God, we thank you so much for your grace. God, I'm thankful that, God, we don't always understand what you're doing around us and through us. God, we can't always see the plan that you are working, but God, we trust you today. God, help us to trust you. Help our unbelief. God, help the things that we are holding back and we are unsure about. God, allow the Holy Spirit to come in, draw us towards you this morning. God, we don't want to just live. God, we want that abundant life that you promise in your word. God, you died for it. Father, don't let us live another day in this life unsure about who we are in you. God, I know the Holy Spirit will bring assurance of salvation. There's somebody here this morning that's just not so sure. They've made a profession. They've told you some things, but they don't know if they're saved. God, let the Holy Spirit come in and confirm it today. God, you confirm it. God, let us have no doubts of where we're going to spend eternity. Let us have no doubts of how we're going to spend tomorrow. That if you allow us to live, we're going to live it for you. God, there's some of us men in this room that need to recognize the most manly thing that we can do is walk close to you so that we'll know how to be the husband and the father that we need to be. Father, let us put aside that old man today. Let us be made new in you. Let us live for you and walk with you. God, we trust you today. We believe in you today. We're going to ask these things in Jesus Christ. Our heads are bowed and our eyes are closed. Many have come. Maybe you need to come. Maybe you got something going on. You just need to give it to Christ. Be obedient today. Be obedient to what God's calling you to do. to allow His Word to come in and meet with you. I'm thankful that you're willing to let the Holy Spirit stir you and guide you. And if you have questions, questions about what God's doing in your life, questions about things that you struggle with, or maybe you just got a prayer request and you got something you want us to pray for, you can always fill out that connection card with a prayer request and put it in the offering plate. But feel free to call me or text me or send me a Facebook message, whatever, Instagram, whatever. Send me a message and let's get together and let's talk about it and pray about it. Because, man, we are here to grow in the Lord. I mean, that's what we're here for. And I believe that's why God continues to bless. God is doing things in your life, and you're turning around and impacting the lives of others. And we're seeing people move and come to Christ. And I'm so thankful for you and your faithfulness. So